want to invite you, if you will, to just take your Bibles out. Take your Bibles out and turn with me to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms, the 51st division of the book of Psalms. We're going to look at verses 1, 2, and then verses 10 through 13. Psalm, I believe it's on the screen. Psalm 51. But I really would love for you to turn to it in your Bibles. Psalm 51. Psalm 51. The Bible says, reading from the New King James Version. Reading from the New King James Version. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you. I want to share a message with you today. I've entitled it, Relationship Distress. Turn to somebody and say, relationship distress. I hope that's not your situation, but please bow your heads with me as we pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we come to you now, thanking you for all of your goodness and your mercies toward us, asking one more time that you would put your loving arms around us, keep us. We're praying, Lord, that you would speak a word to us. Help us to receive it. We ask all of these in Jesus' name. Amen. Relationship distress refers to a relationship that's in trouble. Amen. Let's just make it plain. A relationship that's in trouble, at least where at least one person in the relationship experiences stress, anxiety, grief, etc. There are distressed relationships all around us. And the Church of God is not immune to this. Some couples scream and hurl obscenities at each other, while others slowly drift apart. Relationships distress, or relationship distress, can cause the most reasonable and healthiest of individuals to act in the most uncharacteristic of ways. Have you ever seen that? Individuals in distressed relationships display little goodwill or tolerance toward their partner and are quick to judge or criticize. This is what occurs in our marital relationships. But relationship distress is not limited to our relationships with each other. Distress too often occurs in our relationship with God. 2 Samuel, the book of 2 Samuel, go there with me. 2 Samuel chapter 11, beginning at verse 1, a very familiar story. 2 Samuel chapter 11, beginning at verse 1, reading from the New King James Version. It happened in the spring of that year, at the time when kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel. And they destroyed the people of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David remained at Jerusalem. Then it happened one evening that David arose from his bed and walked on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman bathing. And the woman was very beautiful to behold. So David sent and inquired about the woman. And someone said, "Is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" Then David sent messengers and took her. And she came to him, and he lay with her, for she was cleansed from her impurity. And she returned to her house, and the woman conceived. So she sent and told David and said, "I am with child." Verse 6. Then David sent Joab, saying, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." And Joab sent Uriah to David. When Uriah had come to him, David asked how Joab was doing, and how the people were doing, and how the war prospered. And David said to Uriah, "Go down to your house and wash your feet." So Uriah departed from the king's house, and a gift of food from the king followed him. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord and did not go down to his house. Verse 10. So when they told David, saying, "Uriah did not go down to his house," David said to Uriah, "Did you not come from a journey? Why did you not go down to your house?" And Uriah said to David, "The ark and Israel and Judah are dwelling in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are encamped in the open fields. Shall I then go down to my house to eat and drink and lie with my wife? As you live and as your soul lives, I will not do this thing." Then David said to Uriah, "Wait here today also, and tomorrow I will let you depart." So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next. Now when David called him, he ate and drank before him, and he made him drunk. And at evening, he went out and lie on his bed with the servants of his lord, but he did not go down to his house. In the morning, it happened that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. And he wrote in the letter saying, "Set Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle and retreat from him that he may be struck down and die." So it was while Joab besieged the city that he assigned Uriah to a place where he knew there were valiant men. Then the men of the city came out and fought with Joab, and some of the people of the servants of David fell, and Uriah the Hittite died also. Then Joab sent and told David all the things concerning the war, and charged the messenger, saying, "When you have finished telling the matters of the war to the king, if it happens that the king's wrath rises, and he says to you, 'Why did you approach so near the city when you fought? Did you not know that they would shoot from the wall?' Who struck Abimelech, the son of Was it not a woman who cast a piece of a millstone on him from the wall, so he died in Thebes? Why did you go near the wall? Then you shall say, 'Your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also.'" So the messenger went and told messenger came and told David all that Joab had sent by him. And the messenger said to David, "Surely the men prevailed against us and came out to us in the field. Then we drove them back as far as the entrance of the gate. The archers shot from the wall at your servants, and some of the king's servants are dead, and your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also." Then David said to the messenger, "Thus you shall say to Joab, do not let this thing displease you, for the sword devours one as well as another. Strengthen your attack against the city and overthrow it. So encourage him." When the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when her mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Relationship distress. In 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 13, David was anointed to be the next king of Israel. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him from that day forward. As a youth, David had been filled with the Holy Spirit. He was referred to as a man after God's own heart. David had a long and strong relationship with the Lord. He placed his trust in God. I remember as a boy, he delivered his people by killing a giant in the name of the Lord. And when he was a fugitive, fleeing from King Saul, and the opportunity came for David to kill Saul, David refused to raise up his hands against the Lord's anointed. This is the kind of temperament David had because of his relationship with God. But now, a change had come over him. How could this have happened? How could a man after God's own heart do the things that David did? You know, just because you are filled with the Holy Spirit, just because you have been baptized with the Holy Spirit, does not mean that you can't remove yourself from the presence of the Spirit. This week, we've been studying in our Sabbath school lesson about what? Grieving the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30. We are admonished there not to grieve the Holy Spirit. And do not what? Grieve, read it with me. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. You're not reading that. Brother John, your syndrome is still on these folks. Read the text. Read it so I can hear it. Come on. Yeah, yes, yes. We looked at it in Sabbath school, and I believe that this is so important that I'm going to preach on it. Grieving the Holy Spirit. To grieve someone is to cause them to experience great sadness, sorrow, or distress. And the Holy Spirit experiences sadness and sorrow when we force him out of our lives. Key word, force, right? And prevent him from drawing us closer to Jesus. In the book, 40 Days of Prayer and Devotion, book one, Dennis Smith said the following: God doesn't force. What did I say? God doesn't force. When we receive the baptism of the Spirit, he will have a greater impact in our life. We will feel his prompting more strongly. He will be daily putting the desire in our heart to obey God. He will cause us to study God's word and pray more. The Spirit will cause us to begin loving righteousness and hating sin. How many of you want to do all of that? Huh? That's what the Spirit of God does. However, we are always free to disregard his prompting. When we do this, we begin the process of grieving or quenching the Spirit. When we choose to listen to the voice, or rather, when we choose not to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, when we choose not to respond to him, we grieve the Holy Spirit and we begin to draw ourselves away from him. And so grieving the Holy Spirit is really a process of separating ourselves from the Holy Spirit. It's a what? It's a process of separating ourselves from the Holy Spirit. You see, in the original language of the New Testament, the Greek, right? The word translated grieve is in what's called the imperative present. What does that mean? Well, it's a command relating to something that should or should not be continued. It's a command, say it with me, it's a command. It's a command relating to something that should or should not be continued. So in other words, the verse can be read or should be read or understood as saying, talking about Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, it should be read or understood this way. Stop grieving the Holy Spirit, or do not continue to grieve the Holy Spirit. In other words, stop doing what you're doing, or do not continue doing what you're doing. Do not continue to grieve the Holy Spirit. You see, we all fall into sin at times. Amen? We all fall into sin at times. The key is not to allow sin to become a habit. You didn't hear me. We all can fall into sin, stumble on. The enemy will put certain things in your way, tempt you to do certain things that you weren't planning to do. But the key is, don't make it a habit. Are you listening? The more we fail to listen and obey the voice of the Holy Spirit, the more habitual our sin becomes. Sin begins to grow and grow. We look at David. David continued down a path in which he refused to listen to the Spirit of God. First, he looked when he shouldn't have looked. Amen, somebody. Adultery, fell into adultery. Adultery led him to conspire to cover it up. When he saw that his cover-up plan wasn't working, he decided to commit murder. Then he began to conspire to cover up the murder. And he dragged the leader of his armed forces into it. And that's how sin is. The more we indulge in it, the deeper we sink, and the less we hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. You knew you shouldn't have been messing with that stuff, but you went ahead anyhow. You figured, well, just once. It can't be much of a harm, right? Just one time. Then the next thing you know, two times. Then once a month. Once every other month. Next thing you know, once a week. And now you are a continual sinner. Look to your neighbor and say, are you a sinner? You don't want to do that, do you? Anybody have their phone with them? Just raise your hand. You have your phone? Hold up your phone. If you have your phone, hold up your phone. Hold up your phone. These things, let me tell you, these multi-functions. They have a lot of functions. Turn off your phone, first of all. Is the screen off? Hold up. Come on, hold up the phone. You know what else this phone could be? It's a mirror. Go like this. You can fix your hair. Now look into the phone. Are you a sinner? Go like that. Grieving the spirit is a process. Doesn't happen overnight. It's a process, and it's a dangerous process with tragic results. Worse yet, it's a process that may not be easily detected. According to Ellen White in her book, Patriarchs and Prophets, this is what she said. She said, listen, the work of the enemy is not abrupt. It is not at the outset sudden and startling. It is a secret undermining of the strongholds of principle. It begins in apparently small things, the neglect to be true to God and to rely upon Him wholly, the disposition to follow the customs and practices of the world. There was a book many years ago, Creeping Compromise. Anybody heard of that book? See, the enemy comes in slowly, sneaks in, and he starts to do his thing with you. Oh, what's wrong with doing that? You ever hear those questions? I hear those questions all the time. What's wrong with doing that? Listen, if I have to tell you what's wrong, hold on, I don't want to fall. If I have to tell you what's wrong with doing such and such, I'm already concerned. You know why I'm concerned? See, the Holy Spirit is the first person that tells you what's wrong with such and such. You understand what I'm saying? The Holy Spirit is the first person that's going to tell you what's wrong with such and such. So when somebody comes and asks me that question, well, what's wrong with this? This is what it tells me. The Spirit is already working with you. The Spirit is already has you, and you're fighting with the Holy Spirit. And you're looking for a way to rationalize this thing. So, let me go to the preacher. Let me see if the preacher can give his blessings to what I'm doing. Or let me see if the pastor can tell me something that I can disagree with. Because you can't disagree with God. You understand what I'm saying? The Spirit is talking to you, and you know that's a no-win battle right there. So you go elsewhere. You try to look for other people to say, well, I disagree with that and that. And then next thing you know, you're disagreeing with the Word of God. And then you're disagreeing with God Himself. If I have to tell you what's wrong with doing such and such, the first thing in my mind is I'm praying for you because I know you're going through a battle and you're looking for a way out. I'm holding on to the rail here. This thing is serious. Grieving the Spirit is a dangerous process that may not be easily detected. But, Bible says, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, come on. If we confess our sins, the Bible tells us. If we confess our sins, what? He is faithful and just to do what? Forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen, somebody. Amen. You see, the Spirit of God will not force us. We are always free to disregard His prompting. But the Spirit of God will always trouble us. He's going to trouble us. And as long as we are troubled, as long as we can still hear his voice, there's hope. As long as the Holy Spirit is troubling you, there's hope. Amen, somebody. David had slipped far away from God, but the Lord did not give up on him. The Lord didn't give up on him, and God doesn't give up on us. The Lord didn't give up on him, and God doesn't give up on us. But there are consequences. There are consequences. 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. The Bible says, then the Lord sent Nathan to David. And he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man, who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one for the wayfaring man who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. So David's anger was greatly aroused against the man. And he said to Nathan, as long as the Lord, or rather as the Lord lives, that the man who has done this shall surely die. He shall restore fourfold for the lamb, because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. Thou art the man, as it says in the King James Version, right? Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel. I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your keeping, and gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, I also would have given you much more. Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? You have killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword. You have taken his wife to be your wife and have killed him with the sword of the people of Ammon. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up adversity against you from your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor. He shall lie with your wives in the sight of the sun, for you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel, before the sun. So David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die. You, David, shall not die. However, I'm finished. Where's my musicians? However, because by this deed you have given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also who is born to you shall surely die. After all of that, after David systematically, if you please, after David went through a process of pulling himself away from the Lord, after he committed heinous crimes, we would have put David in jail today. Amen. Would have given them the death penalty. after all of that, God kept pursuing him. He kept pursuing him. The Holy Spirit did not just flee, depart from him. He kept pursuing him and was able to help David see his sins. And then after all of that, even after David pronounced a death sentence on himself, God said, look at what I'm going to do. You don't have to die. But that child shall surely die. And you know the rest of the story. David, you know, he went and covered his head with sackcloth and ashes and fasted and prayed. And he was just praying for that child because he knew what he had done was wrong. I'm talking about stepping away from God, grieving the Holy Spirit, not accepting what the Spirit of God is trying to do for us. He's trying to save us. Amen, somebody. He's trying to save us. He's trying to take us in our stubbornness, chisel away our stubbornness, take that heart of stone, make it a heart of flesh. He's trying to take us, and you know, we want to do our own thing. He's trying to say, no, just submit yourself to me. Stop being proud. Confess your sins. Treat your brother right. Treat your wife right. Treat your children right. Amen. So I can use you according to my glory. So I can save you. He's saying, listen, if I didn't love you, I would have thrown you away a long time ago. But like David, he pursues us. And he got David to realize his sins. But things wouldn't happen on David's terms. God had to point out how serious this thing was. And he said, that child got to die. That's how serious sin is. That's how serious sin is. And the consequences of these little things that we do on a daily basis, we don't even realize where we're headed. We don't realize the patterns that we're forming. The process. Closing the door on God. Pulling away. Sadly for many, that's the case. But Jesus is not finished with us yet. I said he's not finished with us yet. He has his way of getting our attention. When he gets your attention, please, listen. Take those headphones out your ears and listen. Don't let things cloud your judgment. Listen. Because pardon for sin is costly. David, you don't have to die. I'm going to pardon your sins. But it's costly. It costs the death of a son. It's going to cost the death of a son. And it's really costing the death, not of your son, God is saying, but it's costing the death of my son. Jesus had to pay the penalty for not only David's sins, but also for our sins. Amen, somebody. This thing is costly. It costs the death of the Son of God, and we don't want to receive the pardon? We don't want to receive the ministry of the Holy Spirit? That's a slap in the face of God. We're standing to our feet. Your heads are bowed. Your eyes are closed. We're praying. And my prayer for you is simply this. When you hear the voice of God calling, if he's saying, return to me, you got to respond. If he's saying, you need to stop doing what you're doing, you have to respond. If he's saying, let me help you, you have to respond. If he's trying to tell you that he still loves you, you have to respond. Don't push him away. Jesus knocks on the doors of our hearts through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. I said, Jesus knocks on the doors of our hearts through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We should not settle for the relationships that we have with God right now. Folks, we haven't arrived. We have not arrived on a daily basis. God wants to draw us closer and even closer to him. Are you listening? And so the Spirit of God is every day moving and trying to bring us into a closer relationship. So you could be in the church 20 years. You're a baptized member. And you could be in danger, filled with the Holy Ghost, but in danger of pushing the Holy Ghost out of your lives. When you hear the Holy Spirit asking you to take another step closer to God, to do something more for him, you have to respond. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. We're praying. Father in heaven, Lord, your Spirit is speaking to somebody here today. Yea, your Spirit is speaking to every one of us in here. And I don't know what the issues of our lives are. I don't know what individuals are struggling with. But I do know that you're calling us into a closer walk with you. Whoever we are, wherever we are, you're calling us into a closer walk with you. And at every step of the way in this process of salvation, you are desiring that we give ourselves fully to you. And so my appeal today is simple, Lord. You hear the voice of the Holy Spirit speaking to you, and you know you need to respond. Just join me up here for prayer. Whatever category you fit in, you're a member, you're not a member, baptized, you're not baptized, whatever category, the Holy Spirit is speaking to you. It may be that the Spirit is saying, I need you to enter into a higher phase of ministry. I don't know. He's saying that you need to give your life to him. I don't know. He may be saying that I need you to just allow me to clean things up. I don't know. But you're joining me here for prayer. Your head's bowed, your eyes are closed. The only reason why you should be having your head up and your eyes open as if you're walking down here. Come closer, come closer. We're praying. We're not going to take long. We're not going to take long, so you need to come now. The Spirit is calling. You need to come now. You need to step out of your seats and come now. Don't push back the Holy Spirit. This is the day that you're going to say, Lord, I'm not going to fight you anymore. Come now. Come now. Come now. Come now. The praise team is going to sing one stanza of that song, All to Jesus I Surrender. and then we're going to pray. Just come closer. Just come closer. Desire to surrender all to you. Many a times we're so weak we can't even give ourselves to you, but we're thankful that your Holy Spirit continues to pursue us. Lord, we don't want to keep running from you. Whatever walk we are in life, wherever we are in our Christian journey, we just want to give ourselves to you and surrender all one more time. So Father, if you are asking us to just step into another phase of ministry, we surrender. If you're asking us to stop doing certain things that we know are wrong in our lives, we surrender. If you're asking us to just turn over our life to you, stop running away from you, begin to commit to you today because we have not given ourselves to Jesus, we surrender. Whatever it is you're asking us to do, we surrender. And we're thankful that you love us. And we're thankful for the ministry of Jesus on our behalf. He gave his precious life for us to be saved. And we don't want to turn our backs on him at such a time as this. And so I ask that once more you would just move through this place, convict hearts, strengthen us, help us to be all that you desire us to be. Restore a relationship, a right relationship in us. Create in us a new heart. Oh my God, help us to be all that you desire us to be. This is our prayer. Let everyone say, amen.